Hello and welcome to the first of a series called Coffee with Gabor and Nurit. It is a beautiful morning here in Budapest, and our first guest in the series is Don from London. And we're happy that it's probably morning for you too.
Yeah. Because
usually our guests are from California or Canada. So if you're watching from California or from Canada,
sleeping.
I hope you're having nice dreams. And you'll watch this later in your own time. So I am Nurit, this is Gabor, and on the other side of us is Don from London. So tell us a little bit about yourself, Don.
Well, okay. Good morning. And it's not so nice here in London, by the way. It's less than sunny. But so what can I tell you about me? Middle-aged man with grown-up children, and I live in London, and I've only ever lived in London. And I can tell you that I've never been on a spiritual path, so that's that, you know, never even meditated. I'm new to that completely. So what else can I tell you? I can tell you that I've had a very average life. I've worked in one industry my whole life, which is the design industry. And there's probably more information than you need in terms of my background. What we spoke about and what we should talk about, I suppose, is I've got my little story to tell you, which I think is probably useful.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And that'll open things up. So my story, the background information is, I haven't been a spiritual seeker at all. In fact, probably the opposite. I don't know anybody. I've never had a spiritual conversation with anybody, over dinner, in a pub, anywhere. It's pretty new to me. Mm-hmm. I've had an ordinary life. Nothing exciting has happened in my life in terms of, you know, no revelation. I haven't done any bungee jumping off a Californian cliff or, you know, nothing exciting in that respect. I've probably suffered unhappiness internally. I've felt that a lot. Depression and a clinical depression at one point. I went to see the doctor and took some medication for a couple of years. I put that down to turning 40, but I don't know if that's the case. Maybe that wasn't the case. I don't know. So nothing extraordinary to tell you in my past. I can tell you that I thought my journey started about a year ago, but actually it's probably more than that because I put some thought into this morning. And so here, okay, so this is the story. So about 5 or 6 years ago, my wife came home with a DVD of a film called The Secret. And I watched this film, and I'm sure you know of the film, and it was a worldwide success, popular culture, and I enjoyed it. I watched it, and I got from it simply that our observations make a difference. That's what I took from it. I probably saw it 2 or 3 times, but I enjoyed it, and it was the first ever sort of look into anything that wasn't entertainment. So another film followed. I can't remember how, but I got my hands on a box set of another film called What the Bleep. I don't know if you ever saw that.
Yeah.
What the Bleep Do We Know?
What the Bleep, yeah. Uh-huh.
Okay, so I got this box set, and it wasn't just the film. It was outtakes and interviews and conversations with the physicists and the neural scientists. And one guy I resonated with, a guy called Amit Goswami, who was a quantum physicist, and he went on to make another movie, apparently. Well, I've seen it, The Quantum Activist, which is another very nice movie. But this all took place maybe 5 or 6 years ago. And so that, I think, perhaps is the beginning. But that was an interest. You know, I enjoyed it. I looked at it. With physics, you know, with that, you hit a point with physics where if you don't read the description of physics, if you can't see, you know, I never did this at school, so if you don't read the description of physics particularly well, it becomes just a philosophical lesson rather than, I couldn't get to the nitty gritty of it, but that's fine. So from there, somehow, I thought, well, there's a lot to this. There's a lot to observation, observer theory and quantum physics and the quantum measurement theory. There's a lot to this. What I've got to do is I'll try and observe myself a little bit and started reading books on psychology because I went down, I was looking into my mind. I was trying to, you know, look into my mind and I found I resonated with a guy called Albert Ellis, who founded something called REBT. I'm not sure if you're familiar. Rational Emotive Behavioral Therapy. Very rational thinking, but it is thinking. Very rational thinking, very, very much a matter of fact. You know, don't, he uses two wonderful words. He uses two words, I think he invented them, horribleize and terribleize. So, you know, a situation comes along and we tend to horribleize and terribleize about this situation when really it's nothing to think about. And that's what we do on a daily basis. And so I read a couple of his books and watched a few of his videos on YouTube, and somehow that led towards going back to some of the people I saw in What the Bleep. Joe Dispenza, I don't know another name. I'm just plucking these names up. Yeah. They're my journey. These are the people that I met and I listen to, and Amit Goswami as well. So that led me in over a few years into just being more aware and thinking about it's possible to be happy and you don't have to listen to your thoughts and you are not your thoughts, which was a sentence I'd heard many times, you are not your thoughts, but it meant nothing to me, really. It's quite difficult language. Well, I found it difficult. So anyway, it comes to a head about a year ago, a little over a year ago. My wife decided to learn to trade foreign currencies, FX trading. She signed onto a year course, a year-long course. And after a couple of months, I decided I'd have a go as well. But she's teaching me foreign currency trading, which I believe you do, or you do something.
I trade futures.
Futures.
S&P and the Nasdaq futures, which is similar.
Candles.
Yeah.
Candles. So anyway, the strategy you can learn, the money management you can learn, that's all learnable. But what's going to make you a trader, from what I could gather, from what I could see, because remember, I'm new to this as well. Trading is new to me. Was your mindset, how you approach trading. You know, if you go in with greed, you'll get in early, or you'll try and run a trade longer than it should run. And if you go in with fear, you won't take the trade. So I was thinking, well, before I start getting more involved with trading, I'm going to look into my mind a little bit and see if I can sort my mind out a bit, quiet it down and become and approach trading mechanically so that I don't have an emotion brought to it. And that was the thinking behind it. So I started investigating and somehow from psychology, I started looking into more spiritual people, more spiritual teachers, the famous ones, of course. I mean, Eckhart Tolle, he sold millions of books, I realized, many years back, and it never fell on my desk. I never read an Eckhart Tolle book until until the end of last year, and I started listening to him. And again, a lot of it didn't make sense. It didn't resonate. It was a lot of words that I could understand, but it didn't mean much to me. Presence, now, these are just words. I know what they mean, but not in that context. So, but I persevered. For some reason, I kept going, and then I started listening to Muji, and they're all links in YouTube on the right-hand side of different people's pages, so they're very easy to find. I found Bert Harding, who one of his videos is very important to this story, which I'll come to, which happened in March. So, you know, I was getting more involved in it. And then at the end of last year, I lost my job. And so from January to this point, I've had a lot more spare time, a lot of free time, which, you know, you can read the press, read the papers, or you can do something a little bit more useful. So I think I've been a bit constructive. I spent a couple of hours a day looking further and further and listening and watching and trying to decipher it and think about it. And as I said, I've never been a spiritual person. So that bit of it. So it's interesting, as well as I was obviously getting something out of it. So, you know, I kept going and listening and watching and reading and trying to understand and trying to decipher. And then somehow on March the 17th of this year, I was watching a Bert Harding video, 10-minute video called Awakening, simply called Awakening. And he took us through, there's a little exercise on there where he says, you know, settle down, close your eyes, relax, and look into yourself, which is, what does look into yourself mean? And to, well, I know what it means now, but I don't know what it meant then. So he talks this process through, you know, imagine or remember when you were a baby, or imagine you're a baby rather. That body changes into the small child, but something else doesn't change. Your awareness doesn't change, you know. And then the body changes once more into a small child, but then something else doesn't change. And so they're thinking, this is making a lot of sense. You know, now I'm a teenager and I'm still the same awareness. A young man, still the same awareness. And then an adult, a grown up, an older man, but with the same awareness, and I have these memories. There isn't a single atom in my body the same as it was beforehand. The bodies are completely different, but there is this awareness of it all. And everything out here changes, all this atomic world of ours changes, but watching it doesn't change. There is an unchangeable thing watching it. And for the first time, that made a little bit of sense. And then simply, was it St. Francis of Assisi who said, from where you look is where you should seek? I think it was St. Francis of Assisi who said that. And something happened at that moment, and I touched, I found, I don't know what it was, I saw the being, or I touched on the being, and it suddenly all made sense. And everything that I had watched in one moment, and literally a moment, suddenly made sense. I felt a peace. It's so instant. And, you know, I'm preaching to the converted here, but it's amazing how, you know, don't fix your mind. Find out who you are. Forget your mind, because with the moment you can watch that and realize that's not you.
Right.
Everything disappears. There are no problems suddenly. And so that's what happened. Now, I didn't know what happened, because I've heard the term awakening. I've heard these terms. It didn't mean anything to me. Well, it does now, but it didn't then. So I didn't know that I'd had an awakening. I just thought this was a huge thought. And things take on a different appearance. Everything looks like they've suddenly got sharp and clean edges. Everything looks new and shiny. And as I say, it's an instance. Now, I think it was 2 days later I tried to get a hold of you, Gabor. Because I saw you speaking on Conscious TV, I tracked down your website and got a hold of you, which actually got a hold of you, Nurit. And so I was asking if you know of a society or a group of people that you can get in contact with that have gone through this change. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, so we emailed each other a few times, and here we are talking. But since, it's 6 weeks now, the first 2 weeks, my God, I mean, you are untouchable. It's unbelievable. I was testing myself. I mean, I've started walking. I've got a beautiful lake near me. I'm very lucky to have it. In London, there's a lake up the road from me. So I walk around this lake very slowly in presence. And it's like I've never been to a lake before. It's the first time I've visited a lake and I've seen ducks. but it isn't, obviously. And so the first 2 weeks are just astounding. And then, you know, you calm down a little bit. And I'm back in the real world much more than I was. But there's this underlying feeling constantly that I don't ever want to shift, by the way, of it's peace, isn't it? It's a joyous, it's not bliss. I'm not walking around so happy that I want to jump, you know, and throw parties. But this underlying feeling of nothing is a problem. All you're doing is observing. It's the realization that I thought my body experienced, and I was my body, and now I realize I experience my body. And that's the shift. And it's so simple. And it didn't take 40 years, which I believe it took you.
I'm so jealous.
It was a bit of free time.
Yeah.
The power of the internet, a bit of thought. And so, I feel very lucky. But I enjoy it and I like it. My wife sees the difference in me. She feels the difference in me. I sort of calm her down a bit, which is quite nice if she gets a little, comes home from work and has had a bad day. And you know, you just point out, well, none of it really matters. Don't worry about that. And look at this now. Enjoy your dinner. Have a conversation with me. And so she's seen this big difference, which is nice. Doesn't know what it is really, I don't think. We've talked about it, but I think you have to, it's an experiential thing. You have to experience it. Words don't do it. I don't think it's outside of communication, isn't it? It is just something you must experience.
Yeah. People who have not experienced it, I would never have known it until I experienced it. You can't know it with the mind. And unless you
start, no.
Like you're saying, you really don't know what it is.
Yeah. You're trapped in that thing. The mind that I spent, you know, more than 50 years trapped in my mind, and now I'm sort of separate from it. And I can see. Anyway, makes life very easy, enjoyable. And Eckhart Tolle makes sense to me now. Everything he says, I can listen to him for hours and hours now. It all makes sense. I mean, I'm interested that how would anybody go on a spiritual path not knowing what's at the end of it? You know, you don't know what's at the end of it. your intellect must be saying, well, there's a reward, or that you must be doing it. It's amazing. It must be amazing to wake up one morning thinking, I must find more.
Yes.
Yeah. Go on this journey for however long it takes, not knowing really what's at the end of it.
Yeah.
But, so I blundered into it, but happily so. And yeah. I don't know if I can add much more, to be honest. It's a short story.
I think Gabor can add a lot more to the not knowing where you're going.
Well, no, first of all, it's great. It's a very, very genuine awakening story. Not that you need any proof or anything, but it's you're genuinely like there.
Yeah. I think you know when you know. You know.
Right. No one can tell you otherwise.
No.
And it's a... In your case, certainly it was a huge advantage not to have any so-called spiritual background and getting lost in the mountains and mountains and mountains of bullshit, basically. And so that was a huge, that was just absolutely wonderful. It's the amazing thing about the spiritual learning is, like you pointed out, is that no one ever defines where are we going with this or why. Why are we learning all this? Secrets of the universe and the chakras and the crystals and what's on the end of the line. And I'm sort of attempting to define and make more sense so people can actually go towards awakening, if there is such an animal. Using the normal mindset, the normal thought processes, using the same thing for so-called awakening makes it totally impossible to wake up.
Yeah.
So that's why there is millions and millions of people trying to do spiritual exercises and yet are not waking up.
Okay, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I mean, it, there's a bit of contemplation needed, which I guess is mind activity.
Yeah.
It must be through the mind somehow, but there's a point where the mind, when you hit the point where the mind can't go any further, that's it.
Yeah.
It is quite simple though.
Yeah.
It's simple. You need to know who you are and or what you are, or you just need to know that everything changes apart from your awareness. And
that's it.
A moment.
Yeah.
And it's a timeless moment. I think I heard someone say, it could be yourself, actually. I think I heard someone say that although it happens in an atomic moment, uh-huh. it's probably timeless, and actually it isn't one moment. It's timeless.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, it's actually when we're in the present moment, really there is no time. There's no time the way we used to think of time at all. Time doesn't exist until the thought starts moving.
Yeah.
So we can observe time, yet it doesn't exist, but we can observe it. we can be in the time zone. Anyway, the most important thing is that it's amazing. Your story is amazing to me because I worked with many people who have been trying and trying and trying.
I wouldn't know of anybody.
Well, tactics, and all of a sudden, yeah. there you are, bang! Yeah. And that's wonderful.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, a bit of spare time, YouTube, and a bit of determination to keep up because the language is difficult. The language, because again, Eckhart Tolle, he says, you know, he can't tell you; he can only point to. So yeah. it's always skirting around the edge of the but it.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a difficult language, and I mean, Muji can. A lot of what Muji can say, I found very difficult, and I understand it all now.
Yeah.
But very, very difficult for me before March the 17th. I mean, that was.
Yes.
Okay. So how do you simplify the language?
Yeah. Once you're there, then you're capable of understanding what they are saying.
Yeah.
But to get there through understanding is not possible.
No, you persevere and... Yeah.
You said something before that's quite significant to me. I don't remember the exact words, but you said when the mind reaches a point where it can't go any further.
Yeah.
Just like it short-circuits itself, and then there's a possibility of awakening.
Yeah.
And you also mentioned that you suffered, and I think... from a lot of people that I've spoken to and interviewed as well, a lot of them reach a point where their suffering is so bad that there's no solution in the mind whatsoever. The mind just cannot figure it out, and bang, they have it catapults them to an inner silence. So it's very, very, very.
Let me just clarify. When I say suffer, I mean. My moments of suffering were in the past. I mean, I haven't been suffering over the past year or two. In the past, I've had awful, down, terrible moments. Things, you know, awful. So I had suffered, mm-hmm. But not currently. So, yeah. but I understand that pain. It's a horrible, awful pain that we've all felt. I mean, I heard your story on Conscious TV about 12 years of depression.
I have depression.
I can relate to that. I can relate to that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not a prerequisite to have horrible pain.
No. Horrible life.
It's just, that was my path. That was what I had to do because I had no teacher. If someone is fortunate enough, fortunate is not a good word. You found the right teacher, the right YouTube, the right everything, and you had a taste of suffering. I think it's almost a prerequisite to have at least a taste of it.
Yeah.
The reason I'm saying it is because, for example, depression, what you and me have had in common, is that you're having an existential crisis, like depression. I remember it was such that I didn't want to exist.
Yeah.
So now you're close to the existence. Now you're close to existence. So from that perspective, you're only a hairline away from waking up. You see, so it helps to have had some suffering.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it is very existential. It's unreal suffering. I mean, it's mind-made garbage, isn't it? It's nothing. You sit in a room, a peaceful room, and get depressed about what exactly? Because at the moment, there's no problem.
That's right.
So I did that for years. I probably made other people's lives miserable as well around me. I have to go and apologize to everybody.
You and I can go on apologizing this spring.
Yeah. So I think it helps, but not everyone. For example, I don't know if Ramana Maharshi suffered at all. He just laid down next to a church, but it's a very, very unique example of people laying down to next to the church and waking up.
But he spent all night contemplating his death.
Death, yeah.
And he had a death experience, which is actually quite similar to the question of existence.
He was contemplating existence itself, and he was so young. Yeah.
That proves the point of the existential issue.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure who you're talking about, though. Sorry.
Ramana Maharshi. He was an Indian teacher. A lot of the contemporary teachers follow him because he taught.
White beard? No.
I don't think so. You can look him up, Ramana Maharshi. The only reason we're referring to him. Sometimes we don't really try not to refer to anybody, but he is one of those guru of the gurus kind of thing that most people in spiritual circles, when they have a discussion and there is a disagreement in something, and then somebody says, "Oh, but Ramana Maharshi says this." Oh, okay.
He's not
an authority.
An authority in that subject, kind of.
Okay. He's not the... So when Bert Harding speaks on YouTube, he has a photograph behind him.
Yeah, yes, that's the one. Yeah.
Yeah, with the white beard. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, that's right. He had a beard.
Yeah.
That's the bit I remember, because who is he? Okay, right.
Yeah, when he was 16 years old, he lay in bed one night, and he started contemplating his death, and he went through all the motions of as if he was dying, and then by the time it was morning, he was done. He was baked.
He was cooked.
He was awake. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's a very unique experience.
Yeah.
I've known so many people who are attempted, and it's a very rare thing to have happened, like Ramana Maharshi. Mm-hmm. Yours is very unique also, and very rare, I mean, extremely. But it looks like there's going to be hopefully more and more of this in the world, because it's so needed, as you know.
Well, the tools are out there now, aren't they? In this box of ours, we've got access to everything we need. We don't really need to go to the bookshop. I mean, it's there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would also recommend, if anyone did want to go, learning to relax is important, which was something that I was very poor at relaxing. And I mean physically relaxing, just letting your muscles relax. I found that to be very helpful prior to all of this as well. So, you know, relaxing and contemplating. And if you contemplate enough messages, you'll find the one that does it. I'm sure it's a switch. It's a wonderful. I'm not going to be looking back. Not hopefully that I know it too well.
You can't
help it.
You can't actually. it'll shift though. It might even bring up old stuff. Don't be surprised. Because, you know, you're basically recalibrating the whole mind.
Right.
And so stuff may or may not come up, and it'll shift. Just don't, whatever happens, just go back to the presence. Go back to the presence. Yeah. It doesn't really matter. And function with it. Ride your bicycle with it. Talk to people and stay present. That kind of stuff.
Okay.
And then it'll deepen by itself.
Okay, all right, good advice.
Okay.
And then, it's a manual you need to write. A little manual you can email to everybody. Yeah. Because there's a lot of pre-awakening stuff out there. Nothing post-awakening. No one talks about, you know, now this has happened, what do you do? Bloody, there's nothing to do next. Learn to relax.
No, the integrating, once it happens in an instant when there's no time, right?
Yeah.
You can only have it now. What takes time is the integration. So now you have no choice. You can't go back, neither do you want to go back.
Exactly.
Now life will start integrating into its new context for you. So all of a sudden, you know, you're going to still do business. You're going to still make money. You still have to go to the bank. Still have to stand in line. You still have to pick up the kids from school. It'll all integrate with a new base. Sometimes I find that, relationship like man and wife connections really gets fixed up, or better actually. In very, very few cases, one of them runs away.
Okay.
For you.
You don't look scary.
No. But it definitely fixes relationships. But there is this integration period.
Okay.
And we don't know how long it will take. So, you know, if a year from now you have something, holy shit, what is this? Just be with it.
Okay.
We don't need to know what it is. We don't need to know why it's there. Right? We don't need to look into the garbage bag to identify what the garbage we just throw in. We just let it be.
Sure. Okay. That makes sense. I mean, yeah, those first 2 weeks to now are very different. I can see.
Yeah.
But it's this is what living is really all about, isn't it? Experiencing and I was going to say, it sort of puts a full stop at the end of it, really. I don't know how much more. It's not complicated. And
there is no more. From here on, all kinds of things become possible for you. Certainly the integration is ongoing for a while, but what becomes possible is alchemy. Alchemy becomes now possible, that you live your life with declarations, and you use the body to create things, to manifest things, to teach things. All of a sudden, I mean, there is more to learn how to operate yourself in this dimension, but as far as arriving, this is it. There's no more. There's no more to learn in the mind. But yes, there is possibilities, all kinds of stuff, but it's not important to know what they are yet.
Okay.
It's just the mind needs to adjust itself to the new platform that you found. So okay. It's the mind's adjusting to it, because you do need the mind to function in this world.
Part of,
which is what the integration is all about. So your mind is getting adjusted to the new, the thing that we can't name.
Right, yeah. It's a transitional period, integration.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. And once in a while, it's a good idea to find, if you can't find anybody, you can find me, but just to have a conversation from presence. So I'm talking to you and I'm totally present.
Okay.
You tell me anything and be totally present. And that's really good practice.
Okay. Well, I wouldn't know who to approach other than via Skype.
Exactly.
So, as I said, I don't know anybody. I've never had a spiritual conversation, and I've never even meditated. I thought I might try some meditation, but I haven't done that yet.
Don't meditate,
don't
please.
Meditate.
No, don't meditate at all. Not you. No, it'll put you back into time, because meditation has a beginning and an end, and you want to be now in the now.
Okay.
Now to be, you can be with a tree, be with a flower, be with a water jug. But meditation itself is. Has become this obstacle, and there's a million different kinds, and they all involve the mind, and people are totally convinced that meditation is something good towards awakening. And in my opinion, meditation is one of the problems that keep people back from awakening.
Okay.
You know, it's became so popular, you know how it is when something becomes so accepted and so popular, but it doesn't mean it's correct.
Okay, I hear you. Yeah.
It doesn't mean it's correct. It's like in trading. If everyone is buying, you might as well look for where is the selling point, you know, to be a contrarian. But so meditation, especially for you, no, but if you're somewhere and you just be.
Well, I like my walks in the park anyway. I go and buy a little cup of tea from the man in the park and sit with the ducks. So,
yeah, that's perfect. Sit with the ducks is fine. Yeah. You know,
that was something that I had to overcome too. As you know, after 40 years, you know, I always was in teachings that set certain time aside to meditate, to do this, do that, or study some philosophical stuff. And what I've come to learn through practicing what Gabor teaches is that what I was doing to myself is creating a separate event in my life. There's a time for this and a time for that. And it actually created a separation. Right. Now I'm meditating. Now I'm washing the dishes. Now I'm doing this. Now I'm doing that. Whereas what I've learned through this is when I'm present, no matter what I'm doing, like you were mentioning before, there's that background. There's a sense in the back of you that is always present no matter what you're doing. That's the integration, part of the integration that we're talking about. And then it's no longer a separate event.
That makes a lot of sense.
And if it's not...
With meditation or yoga, whatever it is, I suppose the thing is I'm now using these 2 hours to be spiritual and the rest of the time I'm back in the real world.
Exactly. Yes. So it's still your story. This is my story of being a meditator. This is my story of being a housewife or a sculptor, whatever it is that you do.
Or go to church every Sunday and then go home and be the wife. You know.
That's a good analogy. It's a good analogy. Yeah.
Stop doing that.
I stopped doing this a long time ago.
I came in at the right time.
No, but that's good advice. No, you're absolutely right. Don't put time aside specially for, live it.
Doing that, it'll only, there's no way for you to go backwards now, but it's like an attempt to go backwards.
Right.
Philosophically speaking.
I'm with you.
The reason people don't get to where you are is because they meditate. And the reason they don't get to, they know too much, and they want to build, they build up information on the top of information about the subject, and they want to draw a conclusion and then draw in more information using the same mindset as we use to build a bridge.
Yeah,
which is correct to build a bridge, but to wake up is becoming an obstacle.
Yeah.
So learning about it, as entertaining as it might be. And believe me, I've had years of entertaining myself with spiritual stuff.
Okay.
It becomes an actual obstacle. And one more thing, for some reason, is coming up. This gentle feeling that you have, gentle, loving, underlying feeling that you have, is your right. It's your right as a human being. Okay. You have your birthright. Touch the hand of God, call it what you want, right? The other good experiences in life, which is in the swing, because you could have an experience that's a much more memorable, higher than this, you know, doing something, doing a very special meditation or a special drug or a special something that makes you very high or a special instrument. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
So all those are great experiences in the mind. And some of the good ones seem to supersede, quote unquote, to be a higher experience than this.
They're more noticeable.
More
and
noticeable.
Yeah. And more excitable.
Now, and here is a but, a huge one. This is your right forever. This is the feeling of existence. That in the swing, although it's more memorable, it's got nothing to do with it. It comes and goes, and the higher you go, the lower you go. The higher you go, the lower you go. So it's totally separate, got nothing to do with your accessing God consistently.
Absolutely. I mean, the swing. Let me. So the brain makes mind, and the mind's function is thought.
Right.
Thought operates like switches. What I mean by that is, if this event happens, then I'm happy, else I'm not happy. It's a programming analogy, but that's the analogy. Now, you can have a high because this has happened. This event has happened.
Right.
But the problem with that, of course, is else, if it doesn't happen, now you're miserable. And you're going to be miserable more long than you will be happy.
That's right.
I've learned that. The underlying, it's not happiness, it's peacefulness.
Yeah.
It's more than any of that swing. But the swing's fine too. I'm still going to enjoy driving at 80 miles an hour down the motorway.
That's right. Absolutely.
But underlying is much more important than the, so that's the swing.
You're fine. You won't have I just wanted to make sure that it's never, that there is that distinction in your head that no matter how high the experience is, it's got nothing to do with this.
Absolutely. No, I know that.
One of the pitfalls. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
I mean, I do see this world. I don't know how this is existential maybe, but I do see this atomic world, which our body is part of and our brain is part of, as I'm not quite sure what I'm trying to say, but that's separate to, we observe that, we enjoy that, that's our playground, that will change and it's ever changing, but peacefulness is not changing, the now is not changing, and maybe I didn't articulate that well, but that's the best I can do.
You did,
Perfect.
Yeah. You articulate very well because you don't have all the spiritual lingo behind you. So that's...
Okay.
You should write a book.
Yeah.
Oh, but I like the Gabor has good wording for it. He talks about the content and the context. So that underlying feeling is more the context.
Yes.
And everything else in life, the swing and the happiness and the sadness and all that is the content.
Yeah.
So that feeling that you're having is more the context.
Yeah. It is the context.
Yeah. Yeah. What people call the emptiness, the openness, and everything else is dancing inside of it. Yeah. Right. Now I get that picture. I got that instantly with that moment. All in one go. It's amazing. Hours and hours of study.
Yes.
Not years and years, hours and hours, but many months. I'll give myself. So months and months of study.
Yeah.
One go made sense.
Yeah.
All of it.
Yeah. Fantastic.
Yeah. You do have to keep with it though, don't you? You do have to stick with it. Because obviously you give up, then you'll get
there. You can't give up.
You won't be able to let it go now.
Yeah,
you might have little dips here and there, but it'll keep at you.
Well, long may it do so, because I'm open for it. And the more you relax into it, the better. That's the other thing.
That's it, exactly.
Yeah, if your mind kicks in and tells you, right, you should really be worrying about that visa bill should be worrying you. And then the more you sort of relax into it, the more you realize, well, ink on a paper doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Exactly. I never thought like that at any point in my life.
Yeah. Neither have I.
We're not trained to be like that at all. We're trained to worry and plan and have a plan B and stuff like that. My brother used to ask me a while ago, he says, so what's your plan B? You know how it is. You have a plan in life, and if it doesn't work, it's plan B.
Yeah, I've done that. Yeah.
Yeah, and I know what he meant. So I now, if he would ask me the question, I would say, plan A is just being in the now, present, and plan B is being deeper in the now. But it means just
deeper.
If something is in front of me that's touching me too much, I just go a little bit deeper, and it stops touching me. So that's plan B. is to go deeper into the now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's what the integration helps you with.
Yeah, yeah.
The whole process of integration that we talked about before helps you go deeper and deeper and deeper.
Okay.
Instead of seeing the things that come up during the integration, sometimes they're not so pleasant. Instead of seeing them as obstacles or terribilizing them, as you
use. That's a great word.
I love that. Then you just see it as an opportunity to deepen, to go deeper inside.
Yeah. Whatever happening, just embrace it, be with it. It'll get you deeper. And the thing also gets fixed up in the process, whatever you embrace.
Everything is always okay anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yes, enlightenment or awakening, whatever it's called, it's should be taught at school, shouldn't it? Lesson number one, know who you are.
Yeah.
Sure. Can you imagine the teachers teaching? Just, never mind this. Just learn who you are.
And everything else will be all right.
Yeah, that's right.
But it's so true, lesson number one, know who you are.
Yeah.
All I can say is congratulations. I don't even know if it's appropriate, but congratulations.
We're happy for you.
We're very happy for you. And, you want to have a conversation or whatever comes up, but it might, just call or write us.
Write to us and we can talk again.
Okay. Well, I have your email address and you have mine. So if I will do. I'll get back to you in a year's time anyway or something and just fill you in and let you know what the first 12 months have been like. I have documented the days. I don't know if you can see that, but I've...
Oh, really?
Well, because I haven't found this anywhere on the internet. And so every day I've come to my computer and I've written a little passage for the day. So once I've done that for a month or two more, I'll read through it, correct it, and then post it somewhere. I don't know.
Perfect.
Yeah. It might be useful for somebody.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. And also it's good for you to review stuff. I do the same thing. I write by hand in a notebook and I've got like a whole big stack of notebooks of notes. But I go back and review them and amazing what comes at you. With the brand new realization of being in this now, I'm reading what happened and that now, and it's an amazing experience.
I'm with you, yeah. Nicely put, yeah. I like it. So.
Well, I think it feels totally complete and correct.
Yeah. I think I don't think we can add. What's to add? Nothing to add.
Nothing, absolutely nothing. We're just delighted.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, and I'm delighted too. And it's very nice to meet you. And thank you for this conversation. As I said, it's my first ever conversation, and currently my only conversation, so.
It's wonderful to have you as our first guest for our coffee. Where's your mug?
That's my coffee.
Here's mine.
Absolutely. No, it's perfect. You see, many times I get very educated, intelligent friends who are learning from me saying, okay, show me somebody.
Like a magic trick.
Show me an example. Where is a person? It's very rare. So there you are,
Okay. Well, if I'm an example of, if it's any help, then yeah.
Yeah, it's been very helpful. And
good.
Our audience enjoyed watching this as much as we have, because it's been absolutely wonderful. Once again, Gabor and I are here in Budapest, and we're speaking with Don from London. So if you want to have coffee with us sometime, just write to info@gaborharsani.com or to info@nuritoren.com, and we'll be happy to set up a nice coffee with you. And if you're in a different part of the world, we'll have an evening coffee with you. So thanks again, and God bless.
Okay.